Now welcome back my dear class 12 student. This is a class of business studies. Very good afternoon everybody. Now we are going through the chapter, the last chapter, that is consumer protection. We have covered all the topic under it. Only one topic is left, that is legal protection to consumer. Legal protection to consumer. Unlike the Consumer Protection Act 1986, there is some other acts also that's also prevail and protect the consumer. What are the other acts that will today I will discuss with you? Now first, the Contract Act 1982. The Contract Act 1982, what this act actually, the act lays down the condition in which the promises made by parties to a contract will be binding on each other. So this act is actually for contract. The act lays down the condition in which the promises made by parties to a contract will be binding on each other. The act also specifies the remedies available to parties in case of breach of contract. Okay. Now, sometimes what happens, you just take an example. Now, I am the businessman and I actually make a contract with a builder who actually make a very big, large project of building houses, that I am actually the businessman of, actually dealer of the cement. Okay, now I actually contract with the promoter or say the builder that I will actually supply total 500 bags of cement in particular company, and the rate is specified that 200 rupees. Okay, now and as soon as you need this 500, from first month we supply 50 bags, next month again 50 bags, and that's why we supply you. But after few months we stop to supply the cement, okay, to the builder. Now builder is now is a very awkward position, so he is not getting the cement, and I am also charging the higher prices. As I actually, when I make the contract, I say to him that I will supply your cement for the next 6 months at the price of 200, but as the cement prices rises, now I am also in very much awkward position, so I have to raise the prices. But as I make contract with the other party, so I cannot raise the prices. So this Contract Act 1982 actually protect the contract what actually done by the two parties, between two parties. Okay, and what are the remedies available, that's also said by this Contract Act. And the Contract Act actually comes set up in the year 1982. We know the Consumer Protection Act actually comes into effect in 1986. Okay, now next, there is another act to protect the consumer, that is Sale of Goods Act 1930. This is also very old act actually. The act provides some safeguards and reliefs to the buyers of the goods. This act, all the acts actually made for the, in view of safeguards to the buyer or the retail consumer. So this act also provides some safeguards and reliefs to the buyers of the goods in case the goods purchase do not comply with express or implied condition or warranties. Now suppose, now here also just take an example. Now you just suppose buy a refrigerator from the Reliance Digital, and in case of purchasing refrigerator, at the time of purchasing, the company is said there is a 1 year guarantee, 1 year warranty is there. If anything defective or anything happen, we will replace the parts, not the whole fridge, the parts. Okay. So this act actually makes sure that you will get the warranties. If you anything you will need after purchasing, if you think the there is a your refrigerator is not cooling enough, okay, then you will actually complain against that, and the sale of the goods act will be prevailed then, and they will give you the protection for the this warranties. Now sometime advertisement also will come for the sale, that's also under sale of goods act. That is one advertisement is come in TV nowadays, you can look that every time you use Sensodyne, so this will actually reduce your sensation. That is when you actually drink cooling water, there is a sensation in the teeth, and this sensation will reduce if you use the Sensodyne paste. Okay, now if you buy this and the sensation is not reduced, then you can actually cheated by the company. But actually the Sensodyne paste is very good and you can use it. That is good for. So the sales of Goods Act 1930 actually protect or safeguards or get released to the buyers of the goods in case the goods purchased do not comply with the express mean what they said about advertisement or implied conditions. Okay, there are different conditions they give or warranties in case of warranties failure. Okay, now number 4, there is another legal protection of the consumer, and the act is formed. That act is name is the Essential Commodities Act 1955. All the case of act, you have to remember the year. You have to remember the year. The Essential Commodities has come into force in 1955. This is also very old act. The act aims at, what is the actually purpose of the act? The act aims as controlling production, supply and distribution of essential commodities. So this Essential Commodities Act actually prevail for essential commodities. What are the essential commodities? Because different type of vegetable, potatoes, okay. These are the essential commodities you need each and every day. So this act actually prevail or actually imply for that type of goods, and that is their what is their aim? Their aim at controlling production, supply and distribution of essential commodities. Checking inflationary trend in their prices and ensuring equal distribution of essential commodities. How they can control? They can check the inflationary position. Is there any black marketing is happening, or anybody willfully actually stored the goods in their godown? Though there is a demand, they are not actually release the goods from their godown. So these type of things, the Essential Commodities Act 1955 actually looks upon. The act also provides for action against antisocial activities. If this type of activities actually happen, they can take action according to this act, that is called antisocial activities of profiteers, hoarders and black marketers. Okay. So this act is very important, the Essential Commodities Act 1955. Now this act still is there, but government is trying to introduce this act, okay, but still there is the act is prevailed, the Essential Commodities Act 1955 for few goods only. Most of the essential goods is out of this Commodities Act 1955. Now there is a, but your focus is what is the purpose of that, what for the act is actually set up. This is your main focus. This type of question actually comes in your examination. And what for this act is prevailed? What is this act actually, and which year this act actually set up? Now, another act which actually protect the consumer is the Agriculture Produce Act 1937. So this is before our independence. The act is actually before our independence, the Agriculture Produce Act 1937. Now, what is the aim of this act? Now, this act stipulates the condition which govern the use of standard and lay down the procedure for grading, marking and packing of agriculture produce. So this act actually govern the use of different standard of agriculture product, and what is the mark through they should provide the act and what is the packing of agriculture produce, agriculture goods actually. This act actually control these things. So this act prescribes great standard for agriculture commodities and livestock products. Okay, what is livestock product? That is the chicken. Okay, chicken, that is a livestock product. This is also under Agriculture Produce Act 1937. So there is a chicken farm is there, they are stored the different actually lots of chicken and they actually sell it. So these are called livestock products. The quality mark provided under the act is known as AG mark. Okay, so in agriculture product you see the how you know the this is a quality agriculture product, and if you see this AG mark, AGMARK, AG mark is a standard agriculture product sign, an acronym for agriculture marketing. Okay, so this Agriculture Act 1937 is also important. Now there is another act that actually protect the consumer, that is the Prevention of Food Adulteration Act 1954, Protection of Food Adulteration Act 1954. Now this act, what is the aim of this act? The act aims to check adulteration of food articles, if there are anything adulterated, that is the mustard oil. Many of time mustard oil is actually adulteration by the different company in different time. Adulteration mean you, this is not only mustard oil, you just suppose you just include with that with some palm oil also. So that is the substandard oil. Okay, so these are called adulteration. So the act aims to check adulteration of food articles and ensure their purity so as to maintain public health. So according to look upon the public health, government actually make this act, that is Prevention of Food Adulteration Act 1954, and that looks upon the adulteration of food article. If anything is happened, and the action will be taken according to this Prevention of Food Adulteration Act 1954. Now, next, another type of act, another type means another actually act that is for protection of the consumer is the Standard of Weights and Measure Act 1976. The Standard of Weight and Measure Act 1976. What is the aim of this act? Now, this act provides protection to consumer. This act provides protection to consumer against the malpractices of underweight or undermeasure. So, this act provides protection to consumer against the malpractice of underweight or under measure. The provision of this act are applicable in case of those goods which are sold or distributed by weight, measure or number. So which goods actually comes under the Standard of Weight and Measure Act, which goods actually sell or distributed through weight, through number, through measure. Okay. Now suppose you buy a 50 kg rice bag. Okay, now when you after purchasing the rice bag, when you come to home, you see that this is, you are not feeling this is a 50 kg bag. So there is a apprehension, you are growing within you that this will not be 50. So you just go to another shop and just with the bag and make a weight, and you find that there is a 45 kg is the rice is there. The bag weight is 45 kg. So that is also a cheating. That is also a fraudulent. So this, if this type of things is happened with you, so this standard of weight and measure act 1976 has some specific some condition, and this under that way you can make a case, and the case will be comes under the standard of weight and measure act 1976. So this is, so weight of the goods should be whatever you are writing in packaging, that should be okay. Okay. Otherwise, consumer will be, the sound is not clear. Okay, now you can hear me. Am I audible to you, Saurabh? Am I audible to you? Am I audible to you, Saurabh? From our end, there is nothing, no problem actually. So the standard of weights and measure act 1976 is for applicable in case for whose, which good, for those goods which are sold or distributed by weight, measure or number. Now there is all an important act for protection to the consumer also set up, the Trademark Act 1999, the very recent this Trademark Act actually came into force. So that is the Trademark Act 1999, and what is the reason, what is the purpose of this act? That act prevents the use of fraudulent marks on products and thus provide protection to the consumers against such products. So what is the main purpose? Main purpose of this act is to prevent the use of fraudulent marks on products and thus provides protection to the consumer against such products. So this act has replaced by the Trade and Merchandise Marks Act 1958. So this act actually, amendment of the act, which act? The amendment of the Trade and Merchandise Marks Act 1958, which has been replaced. Okay. So now take an example. Suppose you are, sometime we purchase the goods according to trademark. What is the trademark? Trademark, you can see that is the sign or something in the packet. Okay. Now you know that is the goods of Imami. This is the goods of Raymond. This is the, so there is always a sign that is called trademark. Okay. So that is the trademark or the, now in case of phone, mobile, just take an example of mobile phone, Apple. Now there is a Apple, there is a sign that the half byte Apple, you can see in the Apple phone backside always. And according to that, when you just go to a mobile shop and you just purchase a Apple phone, and we just seeing the sign of that. But price is same, that is, you know the price of Apple is very high, is that always, because they maintain quality and there is a brand value for that. So after purchasing, when you are using, you can see the some of the features of the Apple is not actually given in that phone. And that time you can feel this is not actually the Apple phone, and you are cheated by the shopkeeper, and so you can even the Apple company, if you use the other company's trademark, so that company generally actually sue against the who actually selling this type of, who are using this type of trademarks. Okay, so trademarks is very unique thing, that is you have to register with the government, and the only the person trademark will be, can be used only that company. Okay, because trademark is also an asset. That is called, you know, in accountancy, you just learn it is a intangible asset. Okay. You cannot see it, but this is actually trademark is an asset. That is a sign of Mercedes car. You see, there is a sign of Mercedes car. By that, you can easily know this car is a Mercedes car. That is the four crossing sign, star sign actually. You can easily understood that. So if any other car company and using this sign, so Mercedes company will not be actually very happy and they will case against that company. So that's why the Trademark Act 1999 is also come for protect the consumer. Now there is another important act. That act is always in very much in our nowadays is very much we are discussing about that, and the act name is the Competition Act 2002, that is very recently come as per the other acts concerned. So the act, what is the aim of the act? The act provide protection to the consumer in case of practices adopted by business firms. Okay, the act actually provides protection to the consumer in case of practices adopted by business firms which hamper competition in the market. The Act has replaced the Monopolies and Restrictive Trade Practices Act 1969. So this Competition Act actually came into force in the year 2002. But the Act, before there is an Act was there, but what is the name of that Act? The name of that Act was Monopolies and Restrictive Trade Act. So that Act has replaced, that is the Competition Act 2002 has replaced the Monopolies and Restrictive Trade Practice Act 1969. And what is the main aim? Main aim to protection to the consumer in case of practices adopted by business firm which hamper competition in the market. Now, very practical example, you can see, you can feel, I can give you, that is in case of mobile company Reliance Jio. Okay, so when Jio actually comes into the market, there is a lots of competitor is there. Okay, lots of competitor. There is a Uninor, there is a Aircel, there is a different company you can before that. So these companies actually nowadays you cannot find because of the aggressive marketing strategy of the Reliance Jio. And as they are the very big company, they are selling their poor services actually very low cost. The first when the Jio started, they started with the free services to the whole India's people. So that is a huge, okay, so lots of people just so nowadays, you can see there is on Jio mobile SIM with them. Okay, one Jio SIM compulsory with them, you can see that, so that is also a monopoly. And for that, government take a decision not to withdraw the BSNL. Jio BSNL is a government company as making losses year by year, but through if there is no other body, that is if there is now operating four actually other three mobile phone actually mobile services company, that is Airtel, that is Vodafone Idea is also merged, there was Idea, but due to the competition they actually merged with Vodafone. This is also very large company, that is the multinational company. They march and they are now competing each other. Still they are competing each other, but government is very much concerned about that, so that nobody, just only one company is not in the market. Minimum two companies should be there, otherwise actually if there is a monopoly of Jio, now what actually happened, the Jio started to charge very higher prices for the data, for the call charges. Okay, so that is actually the Competition Act 2002 always looks around. So that act is very important. Now next, another act also for the safeguard of the consumer is the Bureau of Indian Standard Act 1986. This act also comes into effect with the Consumer Protection Act 1986. The Consumer Protection Act 1986 comes also year 1986, and the Bureau of Indian Standards Act, that is ISI sign, what I seen in the electrical product. So Bureau of Indian Standard has been set up under the Act. The Bureau has two major activities: formulation of quality standard of goods. They have this Act actually formulate the goods is standardized good or not, and their certification, and they also give certification through the BIS certification scheme. So there is a certification scheme, name is BIS. So manufacturers are permitted to use the ISI mark on their products only after ensuring that the goods conform to the prescribed quality standard. Now, the way the manufacturer actually producing or manufacturing their product, so there, according to this Act, there is a ISI, actually Indian Standard, before Bureau of Indian Standard Act, this institute's name was Indian Standardized Institute. Okay, that is ISI mark you can see in the different electrical products, generally, or electronic appliances. So whenever this type of product is manufactured by the manufacturer or produced by the manufacturer, the ISI actually go to this factory and looks upon if they are maintaining all the criteria provided by this Act or not. If they only maintain, then only they give the certificate to them, and according to that, they allow to use the ISI mark on their product. So that is the main purpose of the Bureau of Indian Standard Act 1986. Now, according to the ISI, according to Act, if you see any product is marked with ISI, so you should be sure that quality or standard would be maintained on that course, and their certification actually through this BIS certification scheme. Now, the Bureau has also set up a grievance cell where consumer can make a complaint about the quality of products carrying the ISI mark. So, suppose you purchase, know that ISI mark means that is the goods will be quality product, goods will be okay. Still, if you after purchasing the product, if you find any defective, any you are not actually getting the services, or if there is any problem you are find out, so you can still make the complaint to the given cell, of the Bureau of Indian Standards, which product actually carrying the ISI mark. The most important of this regulation is the Consumer Protection Act. We have learned all this Act, but most important Act we have already learned, that is the Consumer Protection Act 1986, which provide for 6 consumer rights and help consumer in getting their grievances readdressed for any shortcoming in the good purchase or services available. So you can use these Acts also, but if you are not going through or do not know about that Act, so you can directly go to the Consumer Protection Act 1986, and the 6 right is there already given, and there is a 3-tier, I have already discussed 3-tier actually complaint mechanism, that is district forum, state commission, national commission. So you can have, according to the criteria, you can also go to different commission and different forum according to your complaint, for different complaint. Or if you know the specific Act, you go to that, you can use this Act also, or through that Act you can also make a complaint or make a sue against somebody. Convenient way for the retail consumer, most convenient way of the retail consumer is to use the Consumer Protection Act 1986. Okay. This is the most convenient way, but other acts also is there, but this act also for the corporate level. Okay, this act generally use, other acts generally use for the corporate level. For retail investor, the Consumer Protection Act 1986 is mainly used. But it is not that you are not using the other act. You can also use the other act if you know, but in that case you have to appoint a professional lawyer. But you know, in the case of Consumer Protection Act, there is no need to appoint any lawyer. You own can make a complaint, you own can actually hear the cases, or you just act like a lawyer. Okay, so that is the end of the consumer protection chapter, and all the chapter is completed. So next day we start the actually the demonetization is not in, it's already out, deleted from your syllabus. That is the end of the all of the courses, and next day we'll start to discuss about the different sample papers for different year and previous year question, and how the question is coming, what will be, how we'll give the answer, what will be the answer, you know. And this time there is a 20 MCQ question for this, for 2021 examination. Okay, for previous, if you look after the previous year question, there is no MCQ question for 20 marks. There is a question of 1 marks, 2 marks is there, but this year compulsorily there will be a 20 marks MCQ question. So you have to go through the, read the book very carefully and most, because otherwise you cannot answer the MCQ question. But I will discuss the next classes different MCQ question, the case-based question I have already discussed with you. Okay. So I'll discuss, this portion is just left, so I just discuss about that. This is not actually the very important for as per your examination view. Okay. But still you should learn, you should know this act actually. But you should go through in this chapter mainly the right of Consumer Protection Act, what is the different readdressal procedure, what is the different commission, okay, that is the state commission, national commission, different district forum is there, three-tier mechanism of making complaint, that's you should learn, because important of Consumer Protection Act is also deleted from your syllabus. So continue the classes, because you learn more and more as you continue the classes, and you know the how to prepare the examination, because examination will be already announced, it will be happen in the month of May, but date is still not arrived, what will be the date sheet of the examination. So, but before that, the pre-board examination will be happen, and when that will be happen, it will be communicated with you through the our school website. So you should go there and notice will be come. So for today, that is all for business studies. That is, thank you for that. That is the end of the class. For next class, there will be accountancy, so stay tuned. Thank you.